The Illuminati Formula to Create an Undetectable Total Mind Control Slave by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 5. Chapter 4A, Hypnosis. Understanding the Basics of Hypnosis. A Dissociation, Trance, and History of Hypnosis for Programming. Dissociation is used as a defense to protect a person from overwhelming pain and trauma. It is a natural ability of the brain. Hypnosis or hypnotic trance is a form of dissociation. There are a number of types of dissociation: amnesia, somnambulistic states, localized paralyses, anesthesias, and hallucinations. Hypnosis can reproduce all of these dissociative states. The mind naturally hypnotizes itself under various conditions. Perhaps the reader has been driving along a familiar road and the next thing you knew you were arriving home, having driven in a trance. Now let's suppose you are driving to a movie and you are discussing next week's plans with your wife. The complex thinking required to drive just happens. You are awake talking to your wife, and yet on another level you were in trance driving the car. You as a subject were both in hypnotic trance, driving, and awake, talking about plans. There are 5 levels to the subconscious that the mind will naturally dissociate to. The other deeper levels require help to access. People naturally can think on 2 levels. Because people's minds function on multi-levels and there is a continua on a spectrum that runs from conscious to unconscious, it is often difficult to pinpoint just exactly what state of mind the brain is in at a certain point, because there is no single answer. A light trance is where a person is daydreaming about his girlfriend. A moderate trance is where he imagines he is in bed. A deep trance is where he physically feels he is in bed with his girlfriend. Sleep is where one dreams of being in bed. Behavior modification is carried out in the light to deep trances. The deep trance is a very creative level. Hypnosis appears to affect several areas of the brain. The brain stem is modified into the hypnotic state, and the midbrain centers are inhibited so that other areas, the motor, sensory, and memory areas, can be manipulated. Further, not all hypnosis works the same way. Hypnosis can be used on the intellectual part of the mind, the social-spiritual part of the mind, and the primitive reproductive part of the mind. The skilled hypnotist will decide which area he wants and how to work with that area. Both Christians and Illuminati members who are skilled in understanding demonology believe that there is a demonic side to hypnosis also. It should come as no shock to people that in the World Book Encyclopedia hypnosis is listed under magic as a related article, but not under medicine. Some Christians class hypnosis as a form of divination and enchantment. It certainly can be a form of control. In Occultist W.B. Crow's book Witchcraft, Magic, and Occultism, it lists hypnotism as an occult science. There is open debate whether hypnotism is simply part of the brain's natural abilities or if supernatural elements are part of the process. There is no debate that historically, hypnosis for centuries has been the guarded secret of the occult world. During shock or stress, the body's limbic hypothalamic pituitary adrenal system releases substances which encode all the internal and external pieces of information being sensed into a deep level of consciousness. These memories often become dissociated from normal states of consciousness. In other words, when the mind-body returns to the state where it was in during shock/stress, the mind can reassess those memories. However, until the mind returns to this shock state, it doesn't pick up the information it has embedded. The monarch programmers are acutely aware of how the mind functions, and how information and memories can be trapped in the mind. There are different neurophysiological states. Also, there are said to be 12 levels to the subconscious mind. Then on top of this, the mind has the ability to create amnesia barriers. Hypnosis is a valuable tool to move the mind to different neurophysiological states and to get the mind to different levels of the subconscious mind. Hypnosis can also play a role in working around amnesia, since both are types of dissociation. Hyperventilation helps a person induct into a hypnotic trance. Torture, depersonalization, fear, and acute anxiety stimulate the body to hyperventilate. So the fear, Torture and depersonalization are aids for the hypnotist to help induct a person into a hypnotic trance. Hypnotic cues can be given to cause the body to go into various dissociative states. This could be a post-hypnotic suggestion that causes hyperventilation and an accompanying trance state. Hypnotic cues that are tied to everyday objects enhance the programming. Everything in life becomes a cue to reinforce the programming. That may seem on the surface to be an exaggeration, but it is only slightly enlarged from the truth. The programmers do in fact examine a person's life, and then tailor their cues to what the person will be around. For instance, the programmer may force the child to smoke and then tell it that every time they blow out smoke they will think about their master. The programmed alters don't dare not to smoke on fear that they will be punished. The smoking in turn reinforces the power of the hypnotist/master. Much of the good that therapy can do is in effect to detrance or dehypnotize clients. Most of the alters of a monarch system go their entire lives in trance. Common objects in a person's life that can be hypnotically given a programming meaning include music, tones, colors, the sight of a book or Bible, the pyramid on the back of a dollar bill, pictures of God, silk scarfs, jewelry, lights, sounds, TV programs, and countless other things. The limit to this is simply the programmer's creativity. The power of hypnosis is often underrated because the power of the mind is underrated. The mind can decide to control its breathing, heartbeat, blood pressure, and other things that were once thought to be involuntary. The brain produces a substance which is a tiny peptide molecule called enkephalin, which acts just like morphine and reduces pain. The brain can be hypnotically trained to release enkephalin so that the brain doesn't perceive pain. A common hypnotic device for washing away pain is running water. The victim is hypnotically told to go to a waterfall and wash their pain away. According to a programmer, the average healing rate is 3 times quicker under hypnosis than without. The fantastic abilities of the mind to control what happens to it are very remarkable, such as its natural healing abilities, but most of this is being kept a national secret so that it can be used against humanity to enslave us to demonic empowered power-hungry monsters, rather than to benefit humanity. Several people in intelligence agencies quietly bemoan the fact that secret research could be helping humanity instead of controlling it. The human mind has been found to be like an immense symphony orchestra, each part doing what it does best under the guidance of a director part similar to the conductor of an orchestra. A non-multiple's brain delegates responsibility to parts of his brain yet retains control over the process. His mind will shift from one ego state to another, and still retain its identity. In contrast, the multiple's brain also delegates responsibility and shifts from one ego state to another, but doesn't retain a cohesive selfhood or self-identity. The mental mechanisms are similar, but the experience is vastly different. Rather than an orchestra playing together, the multiple's brain is full of competing isolated parts, instruments so to speak, that are playing in isolation. Out of the chaos of all these independent amnesic parts, the programmer through hypnosis and fear then becomes the conductor to help bring order out of chaos. If the multiple is to regain a chance to orchestrate their own life again, they must re-establish communication between the different parts of what should have been their own orchestra, and get internal people to harmonize their music of life. Good programmers do not need to formally induct their victim into hypnosis. However, if they need to, the monarch slaves are well conditioned to respond to numbers being counted and fingers being snapped. Hypnosis was a well-developed art by the early 20th century. And testing and refining continued all along. For instance, the U.S. military was conducting extensive tests of subjects under hypnosis during World War II. In spite of all this, the CIA was still seeking better rapid induction techniques for their slaves during the 1950s. MKUltra Subproject 128 dealt with rapid induction techniques, especially Subproject 128-1. Some of their drug testing was done at Lexington, KT Detention Hospital. The ability to distinguish between magic and hypnotism may not exist for the child in situations where they are witnesses to the power of hypnotism exercised by a programmer. This makes the adult programmer, who is a big person, look all-powerful. Another danger inherent in hypnosis are complications, side effects, that hit a percentage of those who are subjected to it. Hilgard, 1974, discovered 31% of the 120 university students participating in a study of hypnosis had complications that lasted from 5 minutes to 3 hours after trance, which included headaches, dizziness, nausea, and stiff necks. Fritz is aware of one woman who, after the one and only hypnotic session she was the subject of, developed the complication of having nightmares of snakes crawling all over her. For further study, the reader may want to read Machovec, Frank. Hypnosis Complications, Risk Factors, and Prevention, American Journal of Clinical Hypnosis. Volume 31, Number 1, July, 88, p. 40+. Regular gentle electrical stimulation in many parts of the brain, including the lower part of the reticular formation, can change the state of consciousness from alert to sleepy. An electrical band attached to a box is sometimes placed on the victim to produce a hypnotic state. There are several ways to alter a person's state of consciousness, but the most popular one by monarch handlers is to use a combination of drugs and hypnosis. Drugs are used to facilitate hypnosis. Modern drugs do almost all the work for the hypnotist. They place the person in an altered state and make them willing to take any order. Often survivors remember orange or grape drinks, or something else which they were given, which were used to give the child drugs. One monarch slave, Kathy O'Brien, wrote about having been given hypnotic drugs via a grasshopper ice cream drink. Occasionally, hypnosis must be carried out by the programmers on unwilling subjects. They have three major ways to get around this. They can induce hypnosis by disguising what the hypnotist is doing, they can wait until the person is asleep and talk to him while asleep, or they can administer drugs. Also, the network has some high-tech equipment which stimulates the orgiastic state, sexual ecstasy, part of the brain. By moving the body into this state, the mind opens up all the unconscious states. Then sophisticated brainwave machines program thoughts into the person. A computer disk is put into the electric shock machine and it runs a program that sends electric jolts down 6 nodes. The brain's reticular formation serves as the brain's mechanism involved in regulating alertness and awareness. Various kinds of stimuli will enter the brain through its various methods of sensing and learning. With total sensory deprivation, done by placing the victim in a salt water tank with electrodes that shock the body until it stops all movement, the reticular formation will place the mind into a primitive state of consciousness where the programmers can place in post-hypnotic commands to do something on a certain date. The end-time programming, that has monarch slaves doing something at a specific date to create anarchy or to help the Antichrist come to power, has been put in at this level. As previously mentioned, this level achieved by total sensory deprivation of the monarch slave is same primitive level as the brain's commands to keep the heart beating. Depending on what type of signals are coming into it from the various sensing agents of the brain, the reticular formation will then make a decision what state of consciousness to place the mind in. If the reticular formation does not send out alert signals, then the brain will get sleepy. Damage to the reticular formation can cause a coma. The two thalamus lie just above the brain stem. The right and left thalamus are the brain's selective attention mechanism. That is to say, they decide what it is important for the brain to focus its attention on. The right thalamus is connected to attention to visual shapes and the left to our attention to things describable in words. 10 to 15 repetitions at 1 second intervals are enough to cause the brain to lose interest in something. At this point, the neurons in the reticular formation quit paying attention to whatever it is. For instance, your brain will listen to a clock tick for only 15 intervals before it quits listening to a clock in the room. But the brain's alertness can be reactivated by a strong and sudden stimulus like a loud sound or a flash of light. This is why 3 gunshots or 3 flashes of light are used American Samoa standard access triggers for monarch slaves. 3 was also found to be the best number to get the job done. The history of hypnosis for programming. a Masonic magazine for higher Masonic rites where sex magic is performed, entitled Freemasonry Universal, Volume 5, 1929, page 58, states, certain forces are sent through the candidate's body during the ceremony, especially at the moment when he is created, received, and constituted an entered apprentice Freemason. Certain parts of the lodge have been heavily charged with magnetic force, especially in order that the candidate may absorb as much as possible of this force. The first object of this curious method of preparation is to expose to this influence those various parts of the body which are especially used in the ceremony. In ancient Egypt, there was another reason for these preparations, for a weak current of physical electricity was sent through the candidate by means of a rod or sword with which he was touched at certain points. It is partly on this account that at this first initiation the candidate is deprived of all metals, since they may very easily interfere with the flow of currents. Long story short, the Masonic lodges have been using hypnotism and electric shock in their initiation rituals for a long time. The combination of fear and hypnotism combine to help seal the lips of an initiate from telling what in some lodges are secrets of criminal activity. The Brahmin caste in India practice yoga and other meditations where they regularly go into altered states of consciousness. Centuries ago, the Brahmin fakirs learned about drugs, tortures, and magical methodologies to produce hallucinations and altered states of consciousness. The worship of Bacchus in the West and Shiva in the East were similar, as were the bloodthirsty rites of Kali and Moloch. Occultists in India have also gone to cemeteries for centuries, like the Illuminati, to draw spiritual power from graves. When Eastern and Western occultists linked up, they realized they had a great deal in common. The ancient Egyptian writings many centuries BC talk about the third eye and temple trances. Hypnosis appears to have been practiced in these ancient temples. All over the world, altered states of consciousness have been used. The feared Scandinavian warriors called berserkers were in a mildly programmed altered state of consciousness which made them fearless. Be how to program with hypnosis. George Estabrooks was the first major hypnotist to publicly recognize the potential for hypnosis. He contacted MI6 and other military and intelligence groups in hopes he could interest them in the military intelligence potentials of hypnosis. What was George Estabrooks' connection to the Illuminati? George Estabrooks was a Rhodes Scholar, which is an entry-level group for the Illuminati. For those who haven't studied this, it would be appropriate to give a brief explanation of these things. The Illuminati in 1919 created the Royal Institute of International Affairs, RIIA. The Astor Illuminati family were major financial backers of the RIIA. Waldorf Astor was appointed to the RIIA. The American equivalent to the RIIA is the CFR. The RIIA and CFR set up roundtable groups, based on the King Arthur myths, which were initially named by Cecil Rhodes Association of Helpers. High-ranking Freemason and Illuminati Cecil Rhodes also created the Rhodes Scholarship to bring select men from several the English-speaking world and Germany to learn how to bring in the one-world government that the Illuminati has long had planned. The Cliveden estate of the Cliveden Astors, of the Illuminati, has played an important role in the preparation of Rhodes Scholars. Bill Clinton and Fred Franz, the late president of the Watchtower Society, are two examples of men selected for Rhodes Scholarships. Bill Clinton went through the program. However, Franz decided not to go to London in order to help lead C.T. Russell's cult as Oracle after W.T. President C.T. Russell was ritually killed on Halloween, 1916, and his remains buried under a pyramid. He later served as president himself from 1977 to 1994. The Watchtower Society leadership is a front for a part of the Illuminati which practices Enochian magic. The power of Enochian magic is the Watchtowers. A powerful part of Bethel headquarters workers are multiple personalities, and have cult altars who speak in Enochian. Some multiples work in the art department and have been secretly placing hidden occult symbology into Watchtower and Awake magazines. Now back to Estabrooks, who was also himself part of the Illuminati. In his book Hypnotism, which came out in 1946, he wrote in his chapter Hypnotism in Warfare, Again, bear in mind that Estabrooks writes this in 1946 and has been advocating what he writes for perhaps the 15 previous years. This chapter is not taken from a mystery novel. The facts and the ideas presented are, so to speak, too true to be good, but no psychologist of standing would deny the validity of the basic ideas involved. He might, of course, be somewhat startled at our proposed use of these basic ideas and techniques, for he has never given this matter much thought. The use of hypnotism in warfare represents the cloak and dagger idea at its best or worst. Even if we did know the answers to some of the weird proposals in this chapter, those answers could never be given for obvious reasons. The reader must use his imagination, for specific outcomes in specific cases have not been made public, probably never will be made public. Any top-flight physicist is familiar with the basic laws of atomic fission, and he is quite free to discuss those laws. But he may or may not know what is happening on some government research project in this field. If he does know, he is not shouting it from the housetops, probably not even whispering it to his best friend. The same applies to hypnotism in the field of warfare. Our interest here lies in some of the more unfamiliar sides of hypnotism which may make it of use in warfare. Again, no psychologist would deny the existence of such phenomena. The only possible way of determining whether or not a subject will commit a murder in hypnotism is literally to have him commit one. But warfare undoubtedly will answer many of these questions. A nation fighting with its back to the wall is not worried over the niceties of ethics like Nazi Germany. If hypnotism can be used to advantage, we may rest assured that it will be so employed. Any accidents which may occur during the experiments will simply be charged to profit and loss, a very trifling portion of that enormous wastage in human life which is part and parcel of war. One in every five adult humans can be thrown into the hypnotic transsomnambulism of which they will have no memory whatsoever when they awaken. From the military viewpoint, there are a few facts which are of great interest. Can this prospective subject, this one in five individual, be hypnotized against his will? Obviously, no prisoner of war will be cooperative if he knows that the hypnotist is looking for military information, nor will any ordinary citizen if he suspects that the operator will use him to blow up a munitions plant. The answer to this very vital question is yes, though we prefer to say without his consent instead of against his will. We do not need the subject's consent when we wish to hypnotize him, for we use a disguise technique. The standard way to produce hypnotism in the laboratory is with the so-called sleep technique. The operator talks sleep to the subject, who eventually relaxes and goes into a trance, talking in his sleep and answering questions. Now suppose we attach a blood pressure gauge to the subject's right arm and the psychogalvanic reflex to the palm of his hand, just to make everything look shipshape. These devices are for measuring his ability to relax. We also point out that, of course, the very highest state of relaxation will be his ability actually to fall into a deep sleep while we are talking to him. We also stress the great importance of the ability to relax in this modern world of rush and worry, promising to show him how to get results as one end of these experiments. All this is by way of build-up. Probably not one of our readers, if exposed to this procedure, would realize that this was preparation for hypnotism, but would cooperate willingly in this very interesting psychological experiment. We then proceed to talk sleep, much the same as in ordinary hypnosis, carefully avoiding any reference to a trance or making any tests with which the subject might be familiar, all the while checking on blood pressure and psychogalvanic reflex to keep up the front. Finally, we make the test of somnambulism, or deep hypnotism. We see if the subject will talk to us in his sleep without awakening. If this does not succeed, the subject wakes up completely, and in this case we simply repeat the experiment, hoping for better luck next time. But if we do succeed, if the individual belongs to the 1 in 5 club, the subject is just as truly hypnotized as by any other method, and from now on everything is plain sailing. By use of the post-hypnotic suggestion, we simply say, "Listen carefully. After you wake up, I will tap 3 times on the table with my pencil. You will then have an irresistible impulse to go sound asleep. The next trance is just that easy to get, and the subject has no idea that it is the pencil which has sent him off. But we must go even further than this. Once a person has become accustomed to hypnotism, has been repeatedly hypnotized, it becomes very easy for any operator to throw him into the trance. Obviously, this will not do if we are to use hypnotism in warfare. So we plug this gap again by suggestion in the somnambulistic state. We assure the subject that in the future no one will be able to hypnotize him except with the special consent of the operator. This takes care of things very nicely. We sit down with the subject. We are talking about the latest boxing match when the operator taps 3 times on the table with his pencil. Instantly, and we mean instantly, the subject's eyes close and he's sound asleep. While in trance, he sees a black dog come into the room, feels the dog, goes to the telephone and tells its owner to come get it. The dog is of course purely imaginary. We give him electric shock, which would be torture to a normal person, but he does not even notice it. We straighten him out between 2 chairs and sit on his chest while he recites poetry. Then we wake him up. He immediately starts talking about that boxing match. A visitor to the laboratory interrupts him. "What do you know of hypnotism?" The subject looks surprised. "Why, nothing. When were you hypnotized last?" "I have never been hypnotized." "Do you realize that you were in a trance just 10 minutes ago?" "Don't be silly. No one has hypnotized me and no one ever can. Do you mind if I try?" "Not at all. If you want to waste your time, it's all right with me." So the visitor, a good hypnotist, tries, but at every test the subject simply opens his eyes with a bored grin. Finally he gives up the attempt and everyone is seated as before. Then the original operator taps on the table with his pencil. Immediately the subject is in deep hypnotism. We now add another concept. We can coach the subject so that in the trance he will behave exactly as in the waking state. Under these circumstances we could defy anyone, even a skilled psychologist, to tell whether the subject was asleep or awake. There are tests which will tell the story, but in warfare we cannot run around sticking pins into everyone we meet just to see if he is normal. So rapid can this shift be from normal to trance state, the programming state, and so normal will the subject appear in trance, that the writer has used such a subject as a bridge partner. He plays one hand in trance and one hand awake with no one any the wiser. This happens with monarch slaves all the time. Few people ever catch on that alters are under trance. Suppose we deliberately set up that condition of multiple personality to further the ends of military intelligence. Let us start with a very simple illustration. For example, we can hypnotize a man in an hotel in, say, Rochester. We then explain to him in hypnotism that we wish the numbers and state names of all out-of-state cars parked in the block surrounding the hotel. He is to note these very carefully in his unconscious mind but will have no conscious memory of having done so. Then we awaken him and ask him, in the waking state, to go out and get us a tube of toothpaste. He leaves the hotel and wanders around the block in search of that tube. Finally, he returns, apologizing for his delay, saying that it was necessary for him to go entirely around the block before he noticed a drugstore in the very building itself. This, he says, was very stupid of him, but apparently men are made that way. Did he notice anything of interest as he made his walk? Nothing. Oh, yes, there was a dog fight down at the corner. And he described the battle in detail. We now hypnotize him. He knows what we are seeking and at once proceeds to give us numbers and states of strange cars, very pleased with the fact that he can recall 13. He evidently enjoys the game immensely and is quite proud of his memory. Then we awaken him and see what he knows in the conscious state. How many cars are there around the building? I don't know. What are the numbers of the out-of-state licenses around the building? Good heavens, I have no idea. I think there is a California car near the front entrance, but I have no idea as to its number. A friend tries his hand. Now look here. You were hypnotized half an hour ago and you left this room under post-hypnotic suggestion. The subject gets irritated. Look here yourself. I'm getting tired of that silly joke. This is the third time today you pulled it. All right. I was hypnotized and saw pink elephants all over the lobby. Have it your way. And the subject sits down to a magazine, obviously angry that this man cannot find something more amusing to say. Often the hypnotic subject will react in this manner. Push him just a little too far and he becomes irritated, obviously a trick of the unconscious to end the argument and avoid any danger of being found out. The reader's very natural reaction is, why all this rigmarole? There are certain safeguards if we use hypnotism. First, there is no danger of the agent's selling out. More important would be the conviction of innocence which the man himself had, and this is a great aid in many situations. He would never act guilty and if ever accused of seeking information would be quite honestly indignant. This conviction of innocence on the part of a criminal is perhaps his greatest safeguard under questioning by the authorities. Finally, it would be impossible to third-degree him and so pick up the links of a chain. This is very important, for the most hardened culprit is always liable to talk if the questioners are ruthless enough. The super spy. In the instance we are about to outline, we may or may not be dealing with multiple personality. The little experiment I have just cited could be successful with any good somnambulist and would require about 10 hours preparation. The example I now cite would work only with a certain number of the very best somnambulists and instead of 10 hours preparation, we had better allow 10 months. Perhaps we had better start by defending our position. Is it unethical? Perhaps, but science merely states the facts. Now let us return to our presentation. We start with an excellent subject, and he must be just that, one of those rare individuals who accepts and who carries through every suggestion without hesitation. In addition, we need a man or a woman who is highly intelligent and physically tough. Then we start to develop a case of multiple personality through the use of hypnotism. In his normal waking state, which we will call personality A, or PA, this individual will become a rapid communist. He will join the party, follow the party line and make himself as objectionable as possible to the authorities. Note that he will be acting in good faith. He is a communist, or rather his PA is a communist and will behave as such. Then we develop personality B, PB, the secondary personality, the unconscious personality, if you wish, although this is somewhat of a contradiction in terms. This personality is rabidly American and anti-communist. It has all the information possessed by PA, the normal personality, whereas PA does not have this advantage. The proper training of a person for this role would be long and tedious, but once he was trained, you would have a super spy compared to which any creation in a mystery story is just plain weak. This is what the Illuminati have done. They create good Christian fronts, with Illuminati dark altars who can see what the Christians are doing. My super spy plays his role as a communist in his waking state, aggressively, consistently, fearlessly. But his PB is a loyal American, and PB has all the memories of PA. As a loyal American, he will not hesitate to divulge those memories, and needless to say we will make sure he has the opportunity to do so when occasion demands. Here is how this technique would work. We choose a good subject and then let him in on the plot. We disclose to him that he is an excellent hypnotic subject and we wish to use him for counter-espionage. We suspect that in the near future someone is going to try hypnosis on him. He is to bluff, to cooperate to the very best of his ability, fake every test that is made and stay wide awake all the time. The test we fear most is that of an analgesia insensitivity to pain. So we coach him carefully with post-hypnotic suggestions to the effect that even when wide awake and bluffing he will be able to meet every test which may be made here, be it with ammonia under the nose, a needle, or worst of all, the use of electricity, which can be made extremely painful and is easy to use. Under these circumstances it will be virtually impossible to tell whether this man is bluffing or really in trance. The story continues that the master hypnotist thinks he has got a good subject and has hypnotized him deep. Then the subject tells him that he was only bluffing. The whole affair provides a nightmare for any counterintelligence group using hypnotism. They can be totally bluffed, unless they turn to high-tech equipment to see what is really happening. Estabrooks also explains how a man can be hypnotized and told he is only testing the preparedness of security. He is told he has a fake bomb, but is really given a real bomb. The subject is sent to a location, and blows up with the real bomb. The subject blows up with the bomb, so the evidence of the hypnotic lie is lost. Hypnosis changes the threshold of the how the senses perceive. Sensitivity can be increased or decreased, hallucinations can be perceived even though there is the absence of any appropriate stimuli, and things that exist can go unperceived by the mind. For instance, altars who are used for porn are hypnotized not to see the camera. Altars used for any type of sexual service are hypnotized repeatedly to not see faces. The slave will actually see blurs where people's faces are. The programmers like to manipulate. Children are set in front of circus mirrors that make them taller or smaller for programming. They are set in front of mirrors which duplicate their image. Here in Oregon, there is a site with a magnetic anomaly which bends light. It is called the Oregon Vortex. The programmers take small children there for programming. Anything that creates an illusion seems to be noticed by the programmers and is put to use somehow. The CIA has employed magicians like John Mulholland to help them create illusions. Magician John Mulholland wrote a manual for the CIA on how to deceive unwitting subjects. Under drugs and hypnosis, when a small child is set in front of a mirror that elongates its body and/or then shortens, the reality of the programming script seems real. The programmer can hypnotically call upon the child's mind to totally hallucinate seeing something, or he can support the illusion by handing the child a doll and telling it that it is a child, or handing the child a pencil and telling the child it is a flower. A great deal of acting and props are used during the programming. What child can tell fool's gold from real gold? The bottom line is that generally, no matter which way the programmers do it, whether by an illusion or an outright unhypnotic suggested hallucination, the event for the child is real. The majority of traumas are real events, but the scripts that are given are after the trauma are fictional. See, hypnosis can boost the creativity of the victim to adopt scripts. Creativity is a function of attentiveness, playfulness, anxiety, limitations, relaxation, the trance state, responsiveness, and absorption. A good programmer can assist or boost the creativity of the child. The programmer can tell stories and programming scripts in a vivid way, so that the sensory pictures are bold and strong. The child can taste and feel and touch in their minds the script being given them. Besides the language of the programmer, other aids such as fear and drugs can enhance a victim's attentiveness. Playfulness comes naturally to children. They naturally pretend and use fantasy in their play. Because children are innately creative, they are far easier to program. Researchers have also discovered that creativity needs an element of anxiety and chaos in the person's life. If everything is orderly and in perfect harmony, the creative juices will not flow. The conscious mind and the subconscious mind need to grapple. For creativity to be productive, it must occur within limits. For instance, the concerto is created within the limits of a piano keyboard. The programmer, and the Grande Dame and the Grande Mother of the Illuminati victim carefully guide the child's creativity and set limits. The spark of creativity occurs when there is an alternation of intense concentration and relaxation. The programmers must work back and forth between torture and kindness. A light trance will allow the mind to surface creative ideas. That is why writers and composers get ideas when they are in a light trance, driving, in a light sleep, or shaving, or some other place where a light trance occurs. Receptivity is the willingness to accept a creative idea when it comes. The final part of creativity is one's absorption into the process of creativity. The artist may get so immersed into the portrait that he is painting that the portrait seems alive and real, the actual person. This immersion, where things imagined become real, is important to keep the creative juices flowing. The hypnotist/programmer can enhance the creative process by giving the child positive encouragement to reduce their fears and inhibitions to creativity. The programmer could say to the older child, a younger child might be told something else, you take all of your fear of not being creative and put them into a sack. The sack now becomes a bundle of energy. Now imagine you are opening the sack and out of the sack comes a rainbow of energy. It is powerful, it is positive. You are now full of new ideas. You can feel this power surge through your body. Your mind is now clear and focused, you feel confident, sure of your talent and eager to set your new ideas into motion, and you control the energy in your life, you are very successful in controlling the energy in your life, you take a few breaths and relax. You notice the neighborhood around you, there is a beautiful park, you begin to notice how beautiful the day is, and you begin to feel a fresh new energy flowing through your body. The more calm you become, the more enthusiastic and creative you become, you will feel free to create, to enjoy your creative talent, to invent, to shape, and form new and wonderful ideas. This is not to say that the Illuminati programmer or Mother of Darkness assistant will use this type of hypnotic suggestions, but sometimes it does become necessary to teach some children how to dissociate, and how to become creative. If they do not develop these abilities, they may lose their life to the torture. The vital role of movies for hypnotizing small children. As mentioned before, the hypnotist will find children easier to hypnotize if they know how to do it with small children. One method that is effective is to say to the small children, imagine you are watching a favorite television show. This is why the Disney movies and the other shows are so important to the programmers. They are the perfect hypnotic tool to get the child's mind to dissociate in the right direction. The programmers have been using movies since almost day one to help children learn the hypnotic scripts. For children, they need to be part of the hypnotic process. If the hypnotist allows the child to make up his own imagery, the hypnotic suggestions will be stronger. Rather than telling the child the color of a dog, the programmer can ask the child. This is where the books and films shown the child assist in steering its mind in the right direction. If the hypnotist talks to a child, he must take extra precaution not to change the tone of his voice and to have smooth transitions. Most of the Disney films are used for programming purposes. Some of them are specifically designed for mind control. Spinning tops. One method for inducting children into a dissociative state is to have them look at a large spinning top, as the colors whirl around. Carousel rides have also been popular to induce trances. A good sampling of optical illusions can be found in Catherine Joyce's book Astounding Optical Illusions. New York, Sterling Pub. Co., 1994. The illusion the temple makes one feel they are in a passageway leading to a small door. The escalator makes one feel they are going up and down, and could be used for building in an internal elevator. We know that optical illusions have been used, but we are not saying that these particular ones have been. For a programmer to use an optical illusion, he would first submerge the victim into a drugged state with the appropriate mind-altering music and sounds and then flash the illusion onto the wall that the victim was facing. With virtual reality, the child can really be immersed into a weird head trip. The hypnotic voice of the programmer. Programmers will adopt either an authoritarian voice, which is commanding and direct, or a permissive soft tone. Bear in mind, the slave who has the authoritarian voice used on it sees the programmer as God with the authority of life or death over its, his or her, body and soul. The heightened expectation from the commanding tone will increase the suggestion's chance for success. However, a softer tone will relax the victim, and the hypnotist and the programming victim become partners in the hypnotic process. The advantage of the softer tone is that the creativity of the victim is enhanced and participates more in the process. The hypnotic induction becomes more real when the victim participates more in the process. The monarch programmer will either use a monotone voice or a rhythmic voice. Remember, the professor who could lull his students to sleep. He had a hypnotic voice, without knowing it. A sing-song or rhythmic voice is comforting. It can also be used by the programmer. One continuous thread of words strung together are used to close out distractions. After a suggestion or command is given, a pause is made by the programmer in talking so that the suggestion is taken into the mind. Otherwise, anxiety is experienced by the victim's mind, and the suggestion will not be accepted as well. Cisco, the co-author, provides an example of how a hypnotic script can go with music: close your eyes, for your eyes will only tell the truth. And the truth isn't what you want to see. In the dark, it is easy to pretend that the truth is what it ought to be. Softly, deftly, music shall caress you. Hear it, feel it, secretly possess you. Open up your mind, let your fantasies unwind in this darkness which you know you cannot fight. The darkness of the music of the night. Close your eyes, start a journey through a strange new world. Leave all thoughts of the world you knew before. Close your eyes and let music set you free. Only then can you belong to me. Floating, falling, sweet intoxication. Touch me, trust me, savor each sensation. Let the dream begin, let your darker side give in to the power of the music I write. You alone can make my song take flight. Help me make the music of the night. Helpless to resist the notes I write, for I compose the music of the night. Hearing is believing, music is deceiving. Hot as lightning, soft as candlelight. Dare you trust the music of the night? When the authors have bumped into men who are programmers and handlers for the CIA, they have noticed that many of these men have warm personalities and have a certain trained hypnotic voice which they use even when not programming. During rituals, the various magical languages used in witchcraft employ repetition, alliteration, nonsense syllables, newly coined words, and ancient words that are chanted or sung in a limited range that makes the sounds become hypnotic. Sounds like the mantra AUUNIN are chanted. Gestures during rituals are also made which intensify the effects. Rituals cannot be classified as having nothing to do with programming. There is such a great attempt to secularize and make clinical what the victim experiences, and the idea that witchcraft is part of the programming is an unpopular notion with some. Combining witchcraft with hypnotic language can be powerful with group dynamics. Repetitive sounds, such as a drum beating, influences the locus coeruleus part of the brain. Drums can help induce trance, keeping the mind dissociative. Illuminati parents, as well as other adults who care for a monarch child, are given special instructions on how to raise the child to be dissociative. The parents are admonished that their child will have a successful future, and so will they if they follow the instructions. If they don't follow the instructions, they are minded their child's life could be forfeited. Here are some of the types of instructions that are given. A. Spend 15 minutes each day teaching the child to write backwards to develop the brain in a particular fashion. B. Giving daily doses of prolonged isolation, such as dark closets, dark cellars, the corners of dark rooms. During the prolonged isolation, the child cannot turn on the lights, go to the bathroom, make a noise or anything else. The child will learn to dissociate. The child is also trauma bonded to the abuser, because each time the child is let out, it is grateful to the abuser. The child can be drowned in a pool and then resuscitated, and the exact amount of time to keep the child under will be given. The child can be placed in a freezer, and again the exact amount of time can be given to the parent. The child is not to roam about the house freely. The adult's area is off limits. The child must move with permission. See systematic punishment without provocation with the message keep secrets. Hear no evil, see no evil, do no evil. This needs to be done several times a week to reinforce the codes of silence and the programming for silence. D. A needle which is gripped halfway up is stuck into the child a quarter inch deep on the child's muscles, buttocks, or thigh to help continue dissociative behavior. On special occasions, birthdays, holidays, the hands and feet, which are most sensitive to pain, are stuck. When the feet or hands are stuck, they will often stick the needles under the nails. The ears are also on occasion stuck with needles. It also conditions the child to obey the commands of her handlers, who who will use needles to access the mind's various personalities. Various spots on the body when stuck with needles along with certain codes become access points for certain alters. Any time a child argues, has a temper tantrum, or gets angry, the child is to be slapped in the face. This is a quick trauma. It is to be followed with a lighted cigarette applied to the child to burn the skin the second the child gets submissive from the slap. If a cigarette can't be found, a stovetop or some other hot item is to be found. At 4 years of age, the child begins programming to burn itself. If there are any bruises showing, the child can be kept home for a day or two. If any time the child becomes willful, it is to have its mouth washed out with soap. The child should be made to chew off a piece and swallow the foam. The child should be raped daily and then tortured. This helps with the sexual programming later, and begins a reversal in the mind that pain is love, and pain is pleasure. Some of the first memories that female monarchs recover are their memories of their fathers raping them. This is because the programmers allow these memories to be less dissociated than the later ones where the slave may be sexually servicing an important monarch slave handler like the Rev. Billy Graham. Graham is covered in full in Chapter 5. In later situations like that, the kitten alters which do the sexual servicing will be electroshocked to block their memory as well as given hypnotic cues. The fathers or stepfathers are often not the person who will be their master when they grow up. The abuse of this person will serve as a cover for the programming. If the person's front alters discover they are MPD, the will initially blame their multiplicity on the first abuser they remember, which then serves as a cover. Keeping the mind in alpha state. The entire alter system of a monarch slave has their sleep patterns controlled. Many alters are programmed not to sleep. They stay awake 24 hours a day internally. Someone has to take the body and sleep, but whichever alters are set up to do it, they are hypnotically commanded to only sleep 3 hours, to ensure that the mind stays in an alpha state easy to program. Because alters which do not hold the body rest mentally in a sense when they take the body they are fresh. In this way, a multiple can function without as much sleep as a normal person, but the price they pay is that their mind stays in an easy to program, easy to hypnotize state. REM sleep allows the person to harmonize the mind's inner world with its outer environment. The periods of REM sleep lengthen as the hours of sleep progress. By preventing long periods of sleep, long periods of REM sleep are prevented from occurring, and the victim remains in a more controllable state of mind.